Beste vrienden van KunstKan, wegens het coronavirus gaat de lezing videopresentatie van Viktoria Kova, die aankomende zondag 22 maart om 5 uur zou plaatsvinden, niet door. Maar wees niet getreurd. Viktoria Kova heeft namelijk voor iedereen een film gemaakt om alsnog LANDofGOOD te kunnen bewonderen, die wat betreft de huidige ontwikkelingen erg relevant en waardevol is om naar te kijken. Sinds 2014 werkt ze aan haar project LANDofGOOD, een transdisciplinair onderzoek naar hoe de juiste omstandigheden te creëren voor een welvarende, harmonieuze en duurzame samenleving voor iedereen. Met video's, installaties, simulaties en lezingen onderzoekt zij de impact van de visuele en auditieve informatie op de hersenen en het bewustzijn. Het belang van de vrouwelijke kracht is hierbij één van de belangrijkste uitgangspunten.
Thank you very much, Simone, and KunstKan Gallery, and What Art Can Do Foundation for still having me today under this rather unusual circumstances, to say the least. So welcome to LANDofGOOD YouTube channel. Don't forget to subscribe, please. I wish you all good health and a lot of strength and patience. And I might have some ideas from LANDofGOOD on how to bridge over this time and even to benefit from the situation. If we can't go out, go in. But let's begin by the beginning. I'm here today to share with you an information that your mind will probably immediately label as impossible, even dangerous. Don't mind it. This is because when a certain information doesn't fit the usual concepts of the mind, the subconscious fear of the subject wants to block this information. It's a denial mechanism that our mind is very good at. Science degree biologist Jeremy Griffiths calls it a human condition and explains very well where the subconscious fear of the subject comes from. Check it out if you are interested. So I'm asking you to go beyond your mind and try to feel the subject rather than think it. From my side, I can reassure you that I base my research on authentic scientific researches, so the information will be credible. Using lots of data, my role here is to analyze, summarize, and ordering those discoveries and inventions to deliver a helicopter view in the form of LANDofGOOD. I'm gonna touch down upon quite some multiple disciplines. It might feel like I will be jumping from one subject to another, from archaeology to DNA genealogy, from biology to neuroscience, but I won't, trust me. There is a clear plan in this unorthodox research, which requires unorthodox ways to look at things. Because the creation of new society is such a big, comprehensive subject that includes so many aspects that I propose to approach it gradually. And today we will begin by the very beginning and discuss only the very foundation, the source of LANDofGOOD. For me, the foundation of any society lies in the things that we cannot change. Things that make us who we are on a genetic level. But first, let us start with an easy part, with words, names, and titles. So who are we in our current societies? How do we see, how do we call ourselves? We are humans, representing mankind, living his story. Fortunately, this is something what we can change in LANDofGOOD, because these are just words. So shall we rephrase it to substantiate the following transformation? So from now on, I will say few people, our kind, and our story, if you don't mind. Remarkably, these small adjustments can have such a great power of social transformation of a big scale. Now, let's go further, beyond the words, beyond the superficial. Let's dive in. Today, we gathered here in honor of Equinox celebration. Why is Equinox so important in LANDofGOOD? Because equinox, when the day and night are in perfect balance, is the ultimate manifestation of duality, which always was very important for the pre-ourstoric societies, but not for our current civilization. We don't celebrate equinoxes nor solstices, indicating how far we are separated from Mother Nature. I spent years thinking about what would be the proper foundation of a happy, prosperous society for everybody, including all nationalities, religions, and social statuses. Not only for a happy few, to whom goes 99% of all world wealth distribution, but for everybody. What human quality is the most crucial in everything we do? Is there a code that would lead to happiness and abundance? Having numerous conversations with academics and researchers, philosophers, thought leaders, studying scientific outcomes in the fields of brain and neuroscience, archaeology, anthropology, and sociology, I came to know there is such a code. And that code is duality. It's a ready-to-use formula, actually. And the key to this code is the drive to balance, to harmony, to the golden middle between the two opposites. Under the duality, I understand seemingly opposite or contrary forces that may actually be complementary, interconnected, and interdependent, and they give rise to each other when they interrelate. We do must pay tribute to our male-driven civilization because it managed to soften some of the duality's extremes, such as hunger, thirst, fear of darkness, high risks, at least for the most of us, at least it's available. What seems to be impossible for the male-driven society is to manage the duality between the sexes. That resulted in our world in gender issues. Although the duality of masculine and feminine, what we know as genders, should be as important as the other dualities, even maybe the priority, because how we express our gender goes right to the very core of who we are. Gender is how we identify ourselves. Even people who feel they are born in a wrong body still do identify themselves strongly with a certain gender. And if gender is our foundation, then gender harmony should be the foundation of Land of Good, if we want it to be a harmonious society. Very rare individuals have reached the state of oneness. When they get liberated from our world and lose their basic needs to eat, sleep, interact, procreate, being in the state of nirvana. But for most of us, including myself, are not so far yet. We still want to experience the material world to the fullest. We still want to try everything what's on the menu. For that reason, the harmony between the genders is such a high priority in Land of Good. And the key to the gender harmony is the balance between the best of masculinity, what we call male powers, and the best of femininity, what we call female powers. To create an environment where genders would complement each other instead of compete with each other. So let's have a closer look at the most distinguished male and female powers. We know very well what masculine powers are, right? They're very well represented in our society and organized, pretty much. Everything is structured and controlled to such a degree that no one can get out of its systems. Now, what are the feminine powers? Well, that's a tough cookie. Maybe if we describe the qualities that drive these male institutions, we will be able to describe the female qualities by assuming the opposite. So I figured it out for us, and it looks something like that. And it's not like men have to be like this and women must be like this. No. In fact, both genders possess all these qualities. We all have a different cocktail of them. It's for to be aware that these qualities are identified, encouraged, and applied as institutions, and these are not at all. We don't learn or practice these qualities at schools. We do practice only these ones. In Land of Good, we will aim to practice both. Now, what possible manifestations of these qualities we can find in our society? Well, that's another tough cookie, but then bigger. The most common distinguishing of the female powers would be the ability to give birth to a baby, the irreplaceable role of the mother, household family care. We can call it internal affairs. Now, what else? To bear a baby, cook a dinner, and tidy up is surely not the full potential that comes with the feminine. And I'm going to prove it to you right now, gradually and eventually. Did you know that the practicality of female powers used to be natural for the people in the pre-ourstoric societies? I explored a period of time to find out how they did it. I have a whole video on this channel where I extensively discuss pre-ourstoric role of femininity. Please check it out if you want to know more about this topic. For now, the short version of it. 10,000 BC, the agriculture was introduced. The carbs started to feed the neocortex, the newest part of the brain, which is the home of the mind and ego that grows on carbs, sugars, and domesticated animals. Neocortex started to grow rapidly, taking space from limbic part of the brain. You see, this is limbic part, and the pineal gland. You see how huge neocortex became. As a result, agricultural societies started to replace hunter-gatherer societies, while hunter-gatherers had it pretty much in balance. Because hunters explored outside world through masculinity in order to protect and provide, and gatherers explored the femininity to collect, preserve, and recycle. And that's the balance we are looking for. So those pre-ourstoric societies can actually help us with identifying the role of women in connection with the feminine. And that role was immense. I discuss it extensively on another video on Land of Good channel. According to the new evidence, women with their female touch were responsible for the whole range of cultural and emotional developments, what finally made us human people. So women did it too. And that's a super important premise. Because the capacity and capability of women is the other half upon which we can build the foundation of Land of Good. This acknowledgement of the feminine is backed up by numerous female statues found around the world. In fact, 95% of all prehistoric artifacts are female. So there was a civilization that worshipped women and connected their abundance to the goddess. And that civilization was super successful and sustainable because they managed to build this. And it's not on one location. Amazingly, we find these megalithic structures on all continents. It was a worldwide civilization. How did they accomplish this? Not only they had to have an excellent social organization skills, they also had to have technologies to allocate, carve, transport, and install those megaliths. Some of them are 1,650 tons, and sometimes from granite. Thank you. to architect in these perfect circles the shape that expresses female source, the shape of the Mother Earth. On top of this, it's not built randomly, but aligned with each other. How did they align it 12,000 years ago? Furthermore, they all are also aligned with the stars and constellations. It is aligned so very precisely that it baffles our scientists. How could they see and follow stars with a bare eye? Next to it, there were masters of building tunnels. Very, very long tunnels. They also had a technology to build mysterious chambers. Then, again, long, narrow tunnels. And as the cherry on the pie, there are chambers that look like apartments under the ground with water supply, ventilation systems and storages. In Turkey, they excavated 12 floors deep apartment caves. There are researchers that claim that they used other than energy extracted from heat, meaning they didn't burn anything. Where did energy come from? And they as well had a very different way to nourish their bodies from an unknown source of nutrition. And we don't find any evidence of conflicts. Looks like they interbred and shared their knowledge. Very female approach. And the list of those miraculous accomplishments goes on and on. But I think you got the picture. It looks like the worship of the female, the miracle of birth, the womb of the Mother Earth, the goddess, the inward, the life inside, under the ground, somehow stimulated the way to metaphysical science. While our male-driven world exploring the outside world, they seem to have explored the inner world, the inner cosmos, the inner powers, the black matter, what we call female powers. Going deep under the ground, they might have explored the Earth capacities. There is a whole network around the planet with lots of different types, like for example magnetic fields and underground waters. And the pre-ourstoric society seemed to know how to align with those networks. How did they do it? What kind of technologies helped them to do it? We discussed their poor on carbs and sugars diet that allowed them to develop other than neocortex parts of the brain, especially limbic part and the pineal gland, an organ which today recognized by quantum physics as the possible source of extraordinary abilities such as telepathy, teleportation, move objects with the thoughts and clairvoyance. For the record, from the ancient times, disabilities are related to females. Could that pre-ourstoric society, with the help of metaphysical science, develop a brain and a collective consciousness that made them to discover some amazing, unknown to us technologies? It would be very difficult for me to justify this premise if some enthusiast experimentalists didn't go ahead and perform some small-scale experiments showing that these technologies do exist and do work. Please meet magnetism.
It moves freely.
So this is a clear evidence that technologies extracted from minerals, stones, water, light and sound do exist and do work. Imagine if they were activated by the natural pineal gland capacities to resonate, to vibrate, to transmit and receive energy.
We know by now that the pineal gland is pretty much what represents the all-seeing eye of Horus. It's a receiver, it's a transmitter, it's a powerful tool that we should be using, but we're not because it was manipulated.
Speaking about energies, people are also important generators of energy. We can produce low-frequency vibrations and high-frequency vibrations. Feel bad emotions generate low frequencies. This is pretty much our current society right now, especially fear and worries. Feel good emotions generate supreme fields of high frequencies. That's why emotional education towards feel good emotions will be a high priority in Land of Good. Together with the management and proper maintenance of the pineal gland, which is the center of high frequency metaphysics. People are also important generators and translators of sound vibrations. And when you know how it works, it's ready to do its magic. Sometimes I explore the ancient sites myself. Echo, Land of Good. Sound. Naturally, these technologies are not getting developed in our male-driven society, and I guess you know why. Because they're free, they can't make money on it, so they are non-investable. But our pre-ourstoric heritage teaches us that there is a whole field of opportunities in them. So this niche of possibilities is still available, and Land of Good sees an opportunity in it for the female powers. So in Land of Good, we will fully explore these possibilities of light, magnetism, levitation and sound. We will have a lot of fun with the practicing of the pineal gland, the third eye, in combination with the right technologies. Now that we established this, we can go on and explore the duality even deeper. What would be the right percentage of masculine, feminine per person? How do we measure that? We can try cognitive psychology, analyzing and solving your childhood experiences, the environments you've been through, and the education you received. But this is a tip of the iceberg. But we should go much deeper to our source on DNA level. All our oldest genes are printed into our reptilian brain. It's the oldest part of the brain where neocortex has no access to with its reasonings whatsoever. All genes, since we were mammals, for example apes, are still very important players in our behavioral reflexes and instincts. Judge it for yourself. Please welcome our apes' ancestors. Baboons have a strictly totalitarian male-driven organization, a monarchy based on rigid pyramidal hierarchy and monogamy. Gorillas is also a strict male-driven dictatorship, but with a harem organization. Gibbons is a strictly family-driven social organization. Chimpanzees is a tough, competitive, male-dominated, hysterical, unstable hierarchy, polygamous. Lemur Bambo is very meditative, lives alone and does not need a company. Lemurs Kata live in a big, aggressive troops, reduced sexual dimorphism, that is to say androgynous, without visible differences between male and female. Therefore, their social roles are equal and their social structure is based on gender equality. Females fight in the first lane, carrying their infants on their backs. Female lemurs socially dominate males. Females are independent and choose to mate with other males. but females are not protected by any of them. The death rate of females is very high. 50% do not make it through the first year. Injured and stressed females can't provide enough. They are constantly threatened with starvation and extinction. Bonobo is a non-hierarchical, hippie-like social organization with a leader without privileges, sometimes a female, not aggressive, not vegetarians, omnivores. Males and females are as heterosexual as homosexual. So for the record, Homo sapiens didn't invent anything new in the field of social structures. And no wonder, because human people genome is 98% identical with chimpanzees genome, 96% with gorillas, etc. Once mutated, these genes are passed on from generation to generation as the transmitters of the information. They are practically eternal. And we can't discard them, saying that we are Homo sapiens now, as separate from everything species. This is another concept of the mind which has nothing to do with the reality and truth. As we see, we are the successors of long traditions. That's why we still implement their social structures. However, it looks like different genes are activated in different people. Some of us more bonobos, some more chimpanzees, lemurs, etc. Because of continuous migration, we are all mixed. People with prevailing chimpanzees genes started to live with people of baboons genes, orangutans with chimps. That's why, regardless living within the same culture, some of us like to live in freedom and take full responsibility for all actions. Some of us feel secure with being leaded, following and trusting the alpha leader. Some of us might be better off with a good dictator. And you can't convince a baboon person that gender equality is good for him or her. So this is why I'm showing you all these cute faces, because it seems to be of a great importance which genes are activated in you. For example, my ancestors' line lies in baboons, and through millennia my DNA lived in the Middle East and Balkan. So I'm used to a strong male presence and to being protected and provided by the male. And this is still my ideal social structure preference. A friend of mine looks very androgynous, and her roots are by the lemur katas, the most gender equality apes ever. So to my friend, the idea of baboon social structure is not attractive at all. She just doesn't get it. In general, kort door de bocht, the lesser the sexual dimorphism, the more gender equality minded the individual is. But how to find out our ancestors' line? The DNA test is one of the solutions. But actually, there is a much cheaper way. If you try to feel what your heart is longing to, you will already know. You can meditate on it or just use your imagination. Your intuition should give you some clues. It's important to ignore the mind full of bias based on something you've heard or read or somebody else's opinion. Just listen to your heart. What would satisfy you? Where would you like to live? For example, I would like to live in a gender harmonious society where women play a central role in internal affairs and men would explore the arts of security, reliance, protection and provision. I would love to live under the ground in the beautifully carved chambers made from natural stones that would generate and rejuvenate continuously with their pure energy. One of my inspirations is César Manrique with his underground home on Lanzarote Island. And it's not the choice for the rest of my life. In Land of Good, you will be able to switch and try something else. Not like in our reality when we are chained to our countries, whether we want it or not. So what do we have so far in our quest for the right social structure for you? On one hand, knowing your genes and DNA history will already give you pretty much very good perspective on some of your traits and desires. On another hand, a further, deeper self-knowledge is required because it will fill in the rest of the puzzle. Unfortunately, there is no time in this video to go into the details, but I will make a separate video on the self-knowledge education. For now, briefly, besides the DNA heritage, the self-knowledge includes also the analysis of your astrological line of planetary influence. Furthermore, there is karma, the burden of the past generations that went through wars and dreadful crimes to others, to themselves and to the planet. We must take it into account too, because it's part of who you are too. And then, of course, the knowledge of your own body energies, how to control your vibrations, how to apply the quantum physics law of attraction. Abraham Hicks presenting it brilliantly, how to apply it for your advantage. And concerning our current world, the culture and the environment would also play an important role in the self-knowledge process. Do you feel what a huge potential is in that self-knowledge thing, empowered by the true female powers? Can you feel now how we can make practical use of it? Finding your personal gender balance, your personal cocktail of those qualities will allow to rediscover yourself and eventually to figure out your ideal social structure, your personal ideal habitat in Land of Good. And this cocktail probably won't be 50-50 for everybody. Coincidentally, for me, 50-50 feels like an ideal. But for example, my friend whom I mentioned before feels she wants more of masculine qualities to be present. I'm sure there will be individuals that feel that feminine powers should prevail. For that reason, Land of Good should be not one social structure for everybody, but a network of a wide variety of structures. A free choice between all available autonomous platforms, which are social structures in their pure independent forms. Each platform represents any willing political or non-political party, organization, initiative, way of life, etc. Such a platform should be a self-sustainable unit, an organized community, a society on its own. We call it Ordex. I will share with you the first sketches of my personal Ordex soon. Ordex is a safe settlement where people bind together because of their common needs and ideals, share the same philosophy and making it work for them without an opposition. Ordexes are interconnected but not interfering with each other's affairs unless agreed differently. But how will we keep it all safe? How will we prevent violence? This is where the role of the feminine, of women, and the great mother comes in as a major player. To establish safety, we must go into the importance of the upbringing, nurturing, emotional and social education and training. The nature of violence and aggression lies mostly in the repressed, unresolved emotions coming from childhood. With the right education in Land of Good, masculine powers will know how to manage feelings and desires, and will be educated in violence-free choices. Peace is the matter of education in Land of Good. This makes the role of the mother figure irreplaceable. Therefore, each Ordex will have its own Great Mother. To say right away, Great Mother is not what we understand under the mom. Great Mother is highly educated in mothership science, thought leadership, peacemaking, emotions management, contributionism, pedagogy and medicine, and deserves her position by showing extraordinary abilities in all of this. Great Mother always has a solution. She will have an army of helpers ready to solve any issue, really. All Great Mothers are connected by a global network of all Ordexes. So no matter which gender cocktail, which percentage of masculine, feminine will prevail in your order, the gentle, kind power of the Great Mother stays inviolable. Great Mother is an absolute authority, like is your own mother, with whom you have a strong, loving, stable, trustworthy relationship. She's a soul guardian. Would anybody refuse such a fine safety net in life? From birth to death, a life guarantee of understanding, support in all areas. This gives a very safe feeling for everyone in Land of Good. So this is how we prevent violence and will be able to allow all structures be in Land of Good. The Great Mother will keep an eye on it all. So by summarizing everything we just learned about the feminine, we begin to outline some of the female powers. So let's fill in. As we mentioned before, full responsibility for internal affairs, creating inclusive environments, establishing and leading emotional education and great mothering. We also discuss some potential sources of free energy, the art of giving and receiving based on flexibility stands for contributionism. Many ordinances will be brought under the same roof in Land of Good, representing concord of diversity achieved by negotiating. And finally, the reconnection with the nature through silence, the nature of everything. I think after the zooming in on female powers, we can understand now that feminine leadership is fundamentally important and stands on its own next to masculine. This premise and the law of duality gave me an inspiring idea of dual leadership. Because we are dual creatures, the true steadiness of any society should be secured by the leadership from both sides, the masculine and the feminine. When you get used to this idea, you start to realize how many problems at the source can dual leadership solve for the world. In the times of crisis, like our global coronavirus crisis today, we see how fragile our world is. Today, not only our lives are in jeopardy, but also economy, culture, and security. We actually already knew it when only one month ago, we were facing climate crisis. I don't know if you're aware of the scientist's announcement that we have 10 years to reverse climate change process. If in 10 years we won't succeed, it will reach its tipping point, which will lead to a shortage of air, food, and water. With the heavy deforestation in Amazon, Australia, and Siberia, we can only pray. Feels like we played outside for too long. Feels like Mother Nature is finally calling us in. And the inside is the territory of the female powers, of the goddess. So forcibly we started the process of going in. As the result, in 2 weeks' time, here in Holland, some of the feminine powers start to become visible. We already entered fully the internal affairs. Now we are entering relationships and family area. Mothers are under pressure to provide great mothering and a strong leadership of the family. There are signs of social contributionism. If it will go on like this, and if few people will embrace this opportunity to go in, we might manifest the rest of these powers as well, including free energy. So female powers use this opportunity, I would say. The chance to find the way to hedonism, to the creation, by going on inner journey. If you can't go out, go in. So that when the crisis is over, we can take the lessons of Goddess with us. Meanwhile, please take full responsibility for the overpopulation that might come because of possible baby boom. And pray for the goddess to return, because our god doesn't seem to manage on his own. He needs his goddess by his side. So I made a series of works called Goddess Returns, 7 videos depicting different goddesses as the embodiment of Mother Nature and the ultimate manifestation of the feminine, calm inner presence, deep emotion, beauty, softness, patience, and oneness with nature. You see some fragmentation of pixels through the images, as a sign of overlapping realities. When time and space merge into one, the picture gets distorted, like a hologram of 2 parallel worlds put together. In the likeness of the ancient figurines, I glorify female body, its beauty and potential, in appreciation of female forms as the manifestation of abundance. Created frequencies that are charged with positive and optimistic energy. The colors and motion give a sense of harmony and balance. Good thing is that video art is easy to transfer online, so welcome the goddesses to your homes. Thank you very much for your kind attention. God and Goddess bless us all.